Wait, what just happened?
Oh, I'm sure it'll make sense at the end.
And again, these scenes with Starla really make no sense. Yes, a rip in the space-time continuum and time travel are actually important in this movie. From a storytelling perspective, why did this information need to be conveyed by an obsessed fan pretending to be someone else? It gets worse later on, but her character serves no real purpose in the film, and yet Justin Timberlake talks about her like she's important. But then again, that's his default mode for anything he narrates about in this.
And now it's time for a parody commercial, where we see Wallace Shawn's new Fluid Karma power plant turn on some cars that then proceed to fuck. Yes, cars fucking.
Did I just see two cars pork each other?
Yes, you did. We all did. What the fuck am I doing with my life?
Anyway, Starla gave Boxer a number to call, and it turns out to be Senator Frost's advisor, played by John Larroquette, yet another wasted actor. Boxer is still in crazy mode, but he follows instructions given to him to go to a restaurant, where Frost people pick him up and bring him back to the senator's mansion.
Meanwhile, Ronald meets back up with Sherry O'Terry and another accomplice. He tells them that Dion and Dream are dead, but Sherry O'Terry suddenly refers to him as Roland, his brother, and not as Ronald. She denies doing so, but when he pushes the matter, she knocks him out and kills her accomplice. Wait, what the hell? Then she meets up with John Lovitz, who's working for her? Sherry O'Terry is some evil mastermind? What the friggin' hell is this?
Revelation 22. For it will never be night again, and they will not need lamplight or sunlight.
Okay, Justin Timberlake, when you decide to have a point to these little quotes, please let us know.
The Sean William Scott who fell into a dumpster wakes up that night to find the palm of his hand glowing. And then he decides to give the middle finger. Why? Well, he's amused by this, so good for him. He runs off into the night until he comes across Christopher Lambert, who promptly knocks him unconscious for no discernible reason, though he apparently recognizes him. And don't expect answers to why he did that. Answers for questions are for losers who don't get how deep and meaningful this movie is.
Boxer meets his wife and the senator, and his memory starts coming back together about his life. They drag Krista now into it as well, and what follows is confusing to say the least. Krista admits there's a tape of her and Boxer together. His wife, to be fair, doesn't take it very well, but says they have to pay her off.
And you know what? Maybe now is the time to let you know that I am pregnant with your child.
Miss Krista, did somebody put you up to this?
Yeah. He did. He paid me to bring Boxer back from the desert safe and in one piece.
I wouldn't trust him because you know he's been secretly funding the neo-Marxist movement.
You should be very careful about pointing fingers, Madeline, because I happen to know that you are pregnant with Brands, baby!
What the hell is this, shocking revelation theater?
I was secretly working for Drew Wario the whole time!
I'm not really here!
Can I not be here too?
I'm pregnant!
So then the scene just kind of falls apart. People leave because of business deals, needing to do other stuff. All those big shocking reveals we just had? Yeah, they really have no impact on anything either. Enjoy that completely pointless scene.
Boxer gets another call from Starla, who tells him to go to a pier and that, through the looking glass, he will find what he's looking for.
We saw the shadows of the morning light. Shadows of the evening sun. Until light and shadows were one.
The psychic woman from Poltergeist holding a flashing blue ball while she quotes Jane's Addiction. Yep, it's all coming together, people. We're at the halfway mark of this film, and you can see it makes perfect sense. Oh, and then Wallace Shawn calls up Kevin Smith, who is sporting a beard that ZZ Top would be jealous of.
Justin Timberlake, realizing that the plot has gone off the rails, decides to give some more exposition for us.
The Baron had been conducting experiments on soldiers stationed in Iraq. Fluid Karma. The elixir of God. Injected into the neck. Only a few of us made it home alive. The Baron's quest for global domination was almost complete.
Oh yeah, and Wallace Shawn is trying to take over the world. Did we forget to mention that?
And then the Prime Minister of Japan agrees to cut off one of his fingers so he can get access to Fluid Karma.
Yeah, I forgot to mention that earlier. In the far-off future, transactions are done with fingerprint readings, so severed fingers and thumbs are apparently a black market commodity. The Baron then chops off the Prime Minister's entire hand because... evil? Yeah, this makes no sense.
I wouldn't feel so bad, Mr. Prime Minister. I mean, now you could put a chainsaw in place of that hand.
I could be watching Evil Dead 2 right now. Why am I not watching Evil Dead 2 instead of this?
Alright, well, here's where things get weird. And that's saying something. It's time for Justin Timberlake, the narrator, to take a break, so instead we can have Justin Timberlake, the character. He apparently has his own militia or drug cartel or, I don't know, something, and he runs an operation out of a disused arcade. And yet another new character, Martin, enters and trades some weed for another drug.
Straight up fluid karma. You talk to God.
It's almost like they were on drugs or something.
Oh yeah, that would be the fluid karma. It has nothing to do with anything. Oh, here, have some fluid nirvana.
So what the hell is this stuff? It's an inexhaustible fuel source, but it's also a drug? What the hell is it?
Back in the 19th and 20th centuries and early 21st century, when somebody wanted to get drugged out of their wits, usually moans of energy like natural gas or gasoline or electricity would not in fact get you high but kill you.
And they're also expensive. However, something that can be earned, something that if you were to express yourself in a way that you know, may seem a little,
evil?
Yes, evil.
You're looking for the word good.
Yes, good. If you express good deeds, you can earn something called karma, which, unlike the fluid karma, is intangible. Fluid karma harnesses this energy and tastes pretty delicious from what I've heard of. So
that's actually quite tasty.
You are, what's the name again?
Good.
Yes, you are what you would call a good person, I believe. So, yes. So, try this. I have instilled some of your essence into this. A little bit of your... blood, sweat, and tears, and...
That's what you were doing in my room last night.
Oh, no, that was something else.
Well, science.
Yes.
This is amazing. This is the tastiest thing I have ever put in my mouth. Hang on, what? So...
No, it's awful. It's vile. It tastes like salt and bile and...
What are you talking about? It's like... It's like if ponies and puppies were put into some sort of delicious syrupy concoction of...
No. I don't understand.
No, this is good too. And, fine, I'll drink it for you.
So they trade, and Justin Timberlake takes a hit of fluid karma, leading to a music video.
I got soul, but I'm not a soldier. I got soul, but I'm not a soldier.
Yeah, just out of nowhere, Justin Timberlake is lip-syncing to the killer's All These Things That I've Done while drinking beer and women dressed in Spirit Halloween nurse uniforms dance around him. It's never referenced later, it's not foreshadowed before this point. It just comes in, interrupts the movie for 3 minutes, and then ends.
The depressing thing about this scene is that it's the best scene in the movie, and that's because it has absolutely nothing to do with the rest of the movie at all.
Personally, I'm not all that fond of this sequence, actually, and that's actually because it has nothing to do with the movie. This thing clocks in at 2 hours and 20 minutes long. They could have easily cut this out, and it would have affected jack all.
I'll be honest, I do like the sudden realization Justin has at the end of this video. It's like, wait a minute, I'm not in the Killers. Oh God, I was in a terrible boy band. Yeah, that come down's a bitch.
My face haunted his dreams.
We'll get back to that. In the meantime, episode 6, Return of the Jedi. Their wave of mutilation. Whatever. Anyway, while Wallace Shawn plans to launch a mega zeppelin in honor of the 4th of July, Krista meets with Sherry O'Terry to score some drugs, but then spots the double murder tape just lying out in the open for anyone to see. Apparently, Sherry O'Terry plotted to use it for blackmail money or something. I don't know. It's not very well explained. Krista steals it and decides to give it to the neo-Marxists so they can go public with it.
Krista meets with one of her friends, who tells her how to get the tape to the neo-Marxists. They pass by that Martin guy from before, who has apparently been drafted. Ronald, just kind of walking down the street, spots Martin about to kill himself and stops him. He then recruits Martin to find his brother. And Martin just agrees. Whatever gets the plot moving.
After another pointless scene where the neo-Marxists meet with John Larroquette and then reveal the existence of the second tape, wait, does that mean that Sherry O'Terry was planning on giving them the tape already? Anyway, Boxer Centauros finally meets up with Starla on a beach, and Justin Timberlake watches with his super sniper guard post thing. Starla tells him that the answers he seeks are on board Wallace Shawn's Mega Zeppelin, specifically in his private chambers. How she knows this is anyone's guess, unless Wallace Shawn and his Mega Zeppelin were part of the screenplay, in which case, why does he need to be told this?
What is the secret?
There's a dead body they've retrieved from the desert. They found the body in your car.
He's been dead all along.
What? No, that would be stupid. Wouldn't make any sense.
You're saying that about a movie that has car fucking.
If you should succeed, remember me, my love. Remember my name.
I will.
Well, that certainly was a tense, dramatic scene.
I want to suck your dick.
Okay.
If you don't let me suck your dick, I'm gonna kill myself.
Being an actor, Boxer quickly turns himself into Jericho Kane to try and sweet talk her out of shooting herself. And we see Justin Timberlake loading his giant sniper rifle and aiming it at Starla. Yeah, that makes sense. I'll shoot you before you kill yourself. And yeah, Starla is killed. How did she know about the secret corpse? Why was she so obsessed with the screenplay? We may never know. All we do know is that she really liked Cheetos.
You know, I'm starting to think that this is kind of a weird movie. To make a long, long story short, far too late, Sherry O'Terry and John Lovitz chase after Krista and her friends to try to get the tape back.
Sir, those people are trying to kill me.
Thank you, anonymous bar patron! The two are killed by another sniper station, and this is treated as dramatic and horrible with slow motion action! Except why the hell would we care? These two were villains! Krista succeeds in dumping the tape for the neo-Marxists, while Boxer, still in a panic state after Starla's death, calls on Fortunio for help. However...
Fortunio was on the Baron's payroll all along.
Oh no, not Fortunio! He's a really well-developed character and barely had 10 lines! Remember how good he was an hour and a half ago? We'll really miss him.
Back over to Sean William Scott number one, he starts remembering that something went wrong in Fallujah during his tour in Iraq. However, he can't remember how he got out of Iraq, so that was just another scene to simply remind you that these characters exist. Beyond that, Boxer's taken back to his wife, who seems to have gotten over that whole "you cheated on me with a porn star" thing.
We saw the shadows of the morning light. Shadows of the evening sun.
And again with a Jane's Addiction reference without any context or significance. I think the truth is that one time Richard Kelly heard the song on the radio and just decided, huh, that sounds cool. Why don't I put it in the movie?
Wouldn't surprise me. Every time we cut back to Nana Mae Frost, she's always in this circular room with monitors all around her. With that one, it feels like he saw the architect scene in Matrix Reloaded and decided to shove that in there too.
What does that mean?
Final 3 days.
I'm the Rock. I automatically know that somehow.
It's revealed that Krista now really was in the pocket of Wallace Shawn. Dun, dun, dun.
So, why did he want her to release those tapes? How will this help his goal of world domination?
Oh, I wouldn't worry about that. The world domination subplot is over with.
Huh? What are you talking about?
It isn't brought up again for the last half hour of the movie. That subplot's done with.
What? You can't just bring up something like a plan for world domination and then just forget about it.
Soon my long and hard plan to destroy all of the reviewers on Channel Awesome will come to fruition. It has been years in the making! None will escape my wrath! They will all die painfully and...
This is actually quite boring.
What does this mean?
There is a path to end all suffering.
Line?
You should take it.
Yeah, in one ear and out the other, it looks like. Anyway, the tape is released, though it's so heavily edited, I'm not sure what the hell it's supposed to accomplish with the way it's been put together. Boxer and his wife board the Mega Zeppelin, which is lined with images of atomic bomb explosions. Right, considering in this movie's universe, two atomic bomb explosions killed millions of Americans, that's probably not the most sensitive of decorations.
And really, this scene exists only so Kelly can do one of those long, continuous, unbroken camera takes, which I admit looks good, but it's completely meaningless and useless to the film other than looking nice. It's especially dumb when we start following Walshawn's girlfriend and she just starts dancing around for no reason.
And Wallace Shawn is dressed like Ozymandias from Watchmen. I bet that's why Wallace Shawn agreed to do this movie. It let him wear a cool-looking outfit, even though it looks absolutely hideous on him.
Boxer is led up to a private suite, and on the way, he passes a box with a glowing light on it. That has a gun inside. What, is that box an in-case-of-zombie-invasion-break-glass kind of thing? What the hell?
Revelation 22.
Shut up!
In the suite, he meets Kevin Smith and other members of Wallace Shawn's entourage. And here's where we finally get an explanation for what the hell is going on.
According to the made-up bullshit science of the movie, Wallace Shawn's power generator decelerated the Earth to the point that a rip in the space-time continuum was formed in the desert.
And what did we do once we discovered a rift in the fourth dimension? We launched monkeys into it.
There is something about that line that simultaneously makes it idiotic and brilliant.
Only a human subject could survive that jaunt. The soul of a monkey can't survive the dimensional threshold.
Is this movie trolling us now? Is it just trying to pull whatever the hell it can out of its ass? I mean, how the hell does The Rock know monkeys can't survive? How the hell does he know that a human is the only thing that can? For that matter, why can only humans survive this?
At which point, the Baron decided that the first human subject to travel through the rift would be a movie star.
Why? Why should it be a movie star?
Your celebrity and your political ties proved an irresistible combination.
Just what kind of stupid-ass sense does that make? That's exactly why you shouldn't send him through! People would notice if he disappeared! And they did!
69 minutes before you passed through the rift, a duplicate Boxer Centauros appeared.
You traveled 69 minutes back in time, sir! At which point your future self and your past self confronted one another.
So, I'm my future self. And I'm the dude who traveled through the rift.
And this is all that's left of your past self.
See, I told you he'd been dead all along. Sort of. Anyway, yeah, the paradox of their meeting killed the past Centauros, and the future one has been traveling around ever since. The amnesia caused by the trauma of the incident. It's so simple.
This artifact, this dual existence of a single human soul, could unlock the secret of creation, the secret of humankind.
How? How the fuck could it do that? It's just a corpse caused by a paradox. There is nothing more to it than that.
I don't understand. I've never considered committing suicide.
What? Suicide? What are you talking about?
I'm a pimp. And pimps don't commit suicide.
I don't know whether to laugh at that kind of megalomania or simply cry.
We don't know what would happen if two identical human souls and the vessels that they traveled in were to come into immediate close contact with one another.
Wait. So the time paradox didn't kill him? Then what did? Why am I even trying to untangle this nonsense?
You know what? I take it back. This scene explains nothing. It, in fact, raises many more questions that will never be answered.
Back with Ronald and Martin, Ronald injects himself with fluid karma and starts regaining his memories of Iraq, realizing that he did something to Justin Timberlake. For simplicity's sake, I'll tell you, he's the one responsible for the shrapnel grenade that killed his entire unit and left Justin Timberlake scarred on his face. He feels guilty about it, I guess, but it gets more complicated, as we'll see.
The two stop at an ATM so the kid can empty out his account and go to Mexico to avoid being drafted. The transaction, however, is denied.
We're going to take the ATM machine with us to Mexico.
There is logic in what he says.
Man, there really is a hell of a lot of padding in this movie. We get a sequence where some woman sings a really horrible, bizarre version of the Star Spangled Banner, and this sequence has no reason to be here and could have been cut without any problems. Or hell, if you wanted a song while we saw Sean William Scott rip an ATM machine out of a bag, you just put in another pop song.
Also, during this, the Neo-Marxists have apparently gone into full riot mode and have even sent more people as spies into U.S. ident. Also, we keep cutting back to Roland in the back of Christopher Lambert's truck as if to say, yep, they're still driving. It's been hours and hours, but they're still driving. They're still in this movie.
The Rock notices Wallace Shawn's girlfriend Serpentine at the bar and starts talking to her.
You know exactly what happened out in the desert.
Okay, how does he know that, and why is this important? She hasn't done anything in the movie until now.
Well, we do get a nice big old exposition dump from her. It turns out that Sean William Scott was hired by Wally Shawn to drive Boxer Santa Ross through the time rift, meaning that he doesn't actually have a brother, they're actually time-displaced duplicates. Serpentine then activated the self-destruct on the SUV, because in the future, all cars come with self-destruct buttons, and as a result, she killed the other Boxer. Like I said, it's all simple.
You're a pimp. Pimps don't commit suicide.
Stop saying that!
Serpentine repeats the idea of the paradox, and Boxer says if the two shake hands, the fourth dimension will collapse, and when did an action star get a degree in temporal physics again? And why does Serpentine want the universe to collapse in a paradox or whatever?
Thanks to plot convenience, Christopher Lambert's truck runs into the truck with Martin and Ronald while the rioting continues. And remember, people, this is all because of global deceleration.
Now, bear with us, my friends, because this climax is confusing and stupid. The two Sean William Scotts meet and shake hands, and they can't remove their hands from each other. Somehow, this causes the van they're in to start glowing and floating into the sky. Oh, and this is an ice cream truck, by the way. The climax of the movie is on board an ice cream truck full of guns. Speaking of, Christopher Lambert died and gave Martin a rocket launcher. Because, while all that is going on, there's another musical number. One that's completely incomprehensible as we watch Nana Mae Frost confronted by Neo-Marxists and Fortunio, who kill her. I can't remember why I'm supposed to care.
I said it was a free country!
Dude, this is bullshit!
Aren't you gonna say, I was never here?
Then Boxer Santaros goes up on stage with Krista now and starts dancing with her. Also, she has black hair now. Maybe she got confused and thought that with all the sex references in this movie that this was actually Cruel Intentions too.
Why does it have to be this way? What the hell is going on?
And then for some reason, Boxer's wife goes on stage and they do this weird three-person dance and I don't really know what they're doing.
Thankfully, whatever they were doing is interrupted by Boxer shooting his gun in the air. He puts the gun to his own head and tells everyone to evacuate the Zeppelin, but Wallace Shawn resists this.
Ladies and gentlemen, the party is over. Have an ice apocalypse.
Who is this announcer, and how does he know it's the apocalypse? Does anyone know what's going on?
This is the way the world ends. Not with a whimper, but with a bang.
What is the point of reversing the T.S. Eliot quote? The entire idea behind that quote is that the end of the world, a huge, cataclysmic event, is occurring not with large fanfare and whatnot, but is ending with a whimper. It's irony, dammit! Reversing it doesn't make any damn sense because you'd expect the end of the world to happen with a bang!
In the end, we can be reassured by one undeniable truth. Nobody rocks the cock like Krista now.
You know, Todd, I can rock the cock like Krista now. He told me he liked cocking guns.
So the missile hits the Zeppelin and blows it up, killing everybody on board and probably killing all the people it'll crash on top of. Yep, that's a happy ending.
Oh, and Justin Timberlake stumbles around celebrating that this movie did not hurt his career. That Martin guy commits suicide for some God knows what reason, and we get some final bits of narration.
Revelation 21. And God wiped away the tears from his eyes, so the new Messiah could see out to the new Jerusalem. His name was Officer Roland Taverner of Hermosa Beach, California.
No, 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 no! You are not going to tell me that Stifler from American Pie is the new Jesus!
He is a pimp. And pimps don't commit suicide.
Fuck you, movie! That's how you ended this. We sat through 2 hours and 20 minutes of this garbage, and the coda, the thesis of the movie is pimps don't commit suicide? That's the deep, important message you were trying to convey to us. An inaccurate, stupid statement that you only brought up in the last 15 minutes?
Actually, I have an explanation for this. In an interview with Empire magazine, Richard Kelly explained this frankly idiotic line. If Roland Taverner pulls the trigger and kills himself, the ice cream truck will fall and the gateway opens will close, and it's that gateway that may be humankind's salvation. So suicide represents surrendering to defeat. And pimp? Pimp is American slang for badass, a cool guy. So it's trying to say that our veterans are the biggest badasses that we have. Did you get that? No, of course not, because it's pretentious and nonsensical. So basically, it's a salute to veterans? That's very admirable and noble of you, but Battleship did that recently and look how that turned out. Besides, I'm pretty sure veterans wouldn't want to be called pimps, not to mention that there is unfortunately problems with veterans committing suicide. So yes, this line actually gets dumber after it's been explained. Also, there's no way anyone could have deduced that from watching the film, but so is everything else in it, so that almost seems fucking irrelevant.
That is one of the stupidest things I've ever heard in my life.
I don't know where the hell Richard Kelly got his definition of pimp, but it's not something to be glorified, and it sure as hell not to be compared with veterans.
This movie is a disaster!
It's pretentious, nonsensical, loaded with padding, and even without the padding, it feels like it's 4 hours long while accomplishing nothing!
The world ends because some moron didn't know how self-sacrifice works. Our new Messiah is someone who can't act and would rather let the world blow up because pimps don't commit suicide.
The movie tries to introduce so many ideas but has no insights about any of those ideas. It's just throwing about random crap and hoping something sticks.
The characters speak pretentiously on and on about politics, religion, and the world around us, but they have nothing actually significant to say about any of it.
It increasingly quotes more popular works to give it an air that it's well-read and intelligent, when in fact it uses quotes out of context and twisted from their original meanings.
And all we learn is that we're supposed to live in the suburbs, not in the city.
This is the way the movie ends. Not with a whimper, but with a loud cry of boo.
So this whole time travel and paradox thing, is that why you're dressed as the Seventh Doctor, Linkara? Oh no, I was just wearing this because I'm cosplaying for Magfest. But what about that paradox thing?
Oh, that? Oh, that was resolved a while ago. Other people have reviewed this movie before.
What?
Hey, we're critics. I thought it'd be fun to criticize.
You sought wrong.
You're going to give us this time back, Linkara. Believe me.
What?
Time travel! You are going to go back in time and prevent us from doing all of this!
But how am I supposed to do that? Where am I gonna find a time machine around here?
This is oddly fortuitous.
Oh my, what?
this movie? What is with these scenes? Why is any of this in here at all?
I've got soul, but I'm not a soldier. 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 I've got soul, but I'm not a soldier.
I got soul, but I'm not a soldier.
And what did we do once we discovered a rift in the fourth dimension? We launched monkeys into it.
Aren't you a little short for a stormtrooper?
What? Oh, the uniform.
Hi, my name is Critical Marine. I'm here to rescue you.
Fuck yeah.